As you heard yesterday in the new construction, new development panel, the state of Florida is growing now at over 900 net new residents per day. So that means by the time the sun sets tonight, we will have almost 1,000 more permanent residents. These are net new residents living in the state of Florida. Just these three counties in the southern part of the state, Miami-Dade, Broward County, and Palm Beach County, comprise about 30% of our entire state's population, about 6 million people. So the state of Florida right now has 22 million people. We're projected to have 4 million more people in the next decade for 26 million people by 2030. So a lot of people are coming here. And of course, overlaid with that, in our marketplace, we don't have any land left. When you leave the beach, where hopefully many of you have been this week, when you leave the beach and go west to the Everglades, we only have about 18 miles of dry land, and we have built on most of that now. So to build a single family home in our marketplace, you almost have to demolish an old one to build a new one. And of course, that's why you're seeing all these gleaming new high rises that are coming up. So with that, Teresa talked to us yesterday about the fact that our international sales have been down somewhat these past 4 years, and that's certainly no secret to the global community, and it's not happening just in South Florida. It's happening all across the U.S. and our major cities like New York and Los Angeles and the others, but also across the globe. And of course, and we look at why that's happening. We've had some significant changes in currency exchanges over these last 4 years, as well as some of the countries south of us are going through some economic and domestic struggles with their societies in those places. That certainly has influenced some people not to buy, but other people that are more anxious to buy today. So you'll hear more about that as we talk. So panel, how has the profile of South Florida's residential real estate buyer changed over the past decade that I was just talking about? So from 2007, 2008, we went through the global recession. You know, values on our properties in those years dropped literally in half in some cases. Not all cases, but in some cases. We have regained all that and more now, but in that 2007-08 period, we were selling half of the number of properties that we had been selling prior to that, and now again we're back on track again. But how has the profile of our residential buyer today changed? Jay, you want to start with that?
Sure. Thank you. Thank you for having me. I think what we've seen falls into different segments. On the one hand, we have the size of the population that is traditionally moving into South Florida, so the baby boomer generation, and I think they're like 56 to 76, I don't remember the exact age category, but those people make up such a significant part of our U.S. domestic population, and there's a natural migration of that buyer from whatever market they were originally in down to South Florida for retirement purposes, lifestyle purposes, so I don't think that component has changed, except for the fact that that buyer profile today, I think, makes up a wealthier demographic than it has historically. So we're seeing more of those people making larger purchases, and that's why we see so many of these condos, we like to call them vertical residences, being built with larger square footages, more specific amenitization than what we had historically seen, where there were much smaller units with less sophistication, higher density. But in addition to that, and I think we'll talk about it a lot more, we've seen tremendous amount of domestic migration for tax purposes. And I think that that's something that none of us could have ever anticipated, but it's not so uncommon to what we see in other markets. So for example, when you have political struggle in one market, you can see a lot of investment coming out of that market into safe zones. Similarly, with the tax reform and the state and local taxes having such a big impact on New Yorkers and California residents, we're seeing a tremendous surge in the number of New Yorkers relocating to South Florida. And I think that feeds a snowball effect, because the ultra-high net worth individuals that are relocating into this market are bringing with them many of their employees, which is stimulating all the other aspects of our market, whether it's hospitality, whether it's restaurants, culture, education, hospitals. So we're seeing more teachers, more doctors, more managers, more chefs, more everything. And I think that that's stimulating all the other facets of our market. So the best part about that story is that the people that are coming here now, as opposed to what we saw in like the last financial crisis, was they're not buying here to park money. They're buying here to move here, to own a second or third home here, and that changes the dynamic of that profile into someone that has long-term goals, long-term interests, and I think that's ultimately better for our market and for our economy in Florida.
Any other comments on really the profile of these new buyers?
to back that up, you know, in the long term, I think it's also the long term sustainability. I think today we see a stronger buyer, a more diverse buyer. It's not all one area, one or one country. We're seeing people coming from all over. Obviously, seeking political refuge, seeking protection of their capital, but seeking a long-term process, not trying to buy today to sell tomorrow. And that's been the most important thing for the sustainability of our sales. In addition to that, you're seeing, like you said, a lot of people from the Northeast. That's been a big add. And we're really excited that you're seeing the domestic buyer more and more. And it's not just the foreign nationals. So when they say that we're losing some ground on the foreign nationals, we're seeing a lot gaining on the domestic buyer.
You know, we're talking about a lot of people coming from outside our borders, but we also have a lot of move-up buyers from within. You know, yesterday, as we were talking about new construction, we're talking about more expensive properties. But when you look at our statistics for our MLS and the offerings that we offer as general brokerage, companies, we are finding a large percentage of our sales under $600,000 for both condominiums and single family. So I know that we talk about, oh, everything is over $1 million, but still only 6% of our sales are over $1 million. That means that 94% are under $1 million. Now, you get to hear a lot about those because that's a fun product to talk about, and we do sell a lot more of that at new construction than we do in the resale business. So those numbers I just quoted or the resale market, and I think that we will continue to see that type of a balance. Natasha, I know that you know, you have offices in Miami-Dade and Broward County, and so you see a lot of that middle market,
correct,
and not just on the waterfront, but back into our interior locations. So how do you see the profile of your buyer today?
So the profile of the buyer interior is funny because it's very similar to what we're seeing on the coastal markets. It's just a different price point. So we are seeing a tremendous amount of movement from the Northeast, New York, Connecticut, the high tax states. We're seeing Massachusetts now come, but we're also seeing a lot of Californians move in, especially into the West End markets where you can purchase a property for a quarter of the price of what it would cost them out west to own the same property. The other thing we're seeing is a migration of people and a population having children, and they're moving from our East Coast markets out west for the single family homes for the schools. You know, we looked at, and you know, as we're looking at the numbers, we're seeing the surges in certain segments of the market. You know, cities like Cooper City, where the market jumped almost 30% in terms of units sold, it's the schools that are driving that. So we're seeing that across the markets the same way. And then you have other markets out west where you still see an investor buyer move in, and you're seeing that market still moving.
You mentioned schools. We haven't talked much about schools and education in our marketplace. You know, in Florida now, we have 700,000 college students just in the state of Florida. When you think about that, you know, that's larger than most any place else I've ever heard of with that much education happening.
But I got two of them in that.
You have
two
of them.
I have two of those.
Well, thank you. You're
statistics.
Helping support that. But you know, what are we seeing in our schools? I mean, to give you one example of the diversity of our community, in Miami-Dade County Public Schools, we're the fourth largest public school system in the nation. New York is first, then LA, then Chicago, then Miami. 345,000 students in our public school system, plus thousands more in our private school system. But the data from the public school system tells us that those 345,000 students, these are just kids from 6 years old to 18 years old, just those 12, 13 grades, including preschool, those kids were born in 171 different countries. You know, you hear that? 171 different countries. I grew up in Tennessee. I didn't know there were 171 countries. But when they go home in the afternoon, they speak one of 106 other languages or dialects. So I would argue that Miami may be the most diverse place on earth. And when I moved here in 1975, we were just beginning this diversity. And today, we revel in it. People are moving here because they want to experience it, especially the millennial group. So what are you guys hearing from your buyers about schools now? Are you positive?
Yeah, I mean, if it's a family that intends on having children or they have school-age children, schools are still a priority. I mean, when you're looking location, they do still check what's the schools look like. You know, do we have A-rated schools? What about elementary, middle school, high school? What's the distance? Is there buses available? And what are our private school options? And then we've got charter schools. So we have a variety of school options for people that are looking for that.
Okay. I want to add to the comment made about the price of real estate in our market. We hear it all the time. We're more of a luxury brokerage firm, but when we go up to the markets in the Northeast and we're in Long Island or we're in Connecticut or we're in Boston, oftentimes we hear, is there anything below $1 million? And as Ron pointed out, and it's always so amazing to talk with Ron because he knows every statistic like the back of his hand, but when you hear about how much of our market is really in that price point, well under $1 million, it's I think a point that needs to be more focused upon, because as much as I want to sell multi-million dollar condos and single family homes, the reality is there's a tremendous amount of super high quality product that's in the $500,000 range. And oftentimes when you're coming from a market where that price point is hard to find, people don't realize that they can get a brand new home in a great schooling community where there's parks and less density for a price point that is half of what you would pay, if not more, in some of the more denser Miami, South Florida-based markets. And I think it's a misconception that people think everything here are the multi-million dollar towers or the mansions on the water, where in fact there is a tremendously high quality product outside of those markets that needs to be paid attention to.
I think Ron and I were talking earlier, it's about 84% of our market's below $1 million.
Below 600,000. Yeah, 84% below 600,000.
So it's a big amount. Now, that may not include some of the new development projects that are being marketed that you don't see on the statistics. You know, for example, Una, which is one of ours, which is in the back, that's a boutique, high-end product. But what I really like to talk about with this migration that we're seeing is that we're not just getting people from the Northeast and people with more of a financial ability, we're getting people that have real jobs that are making very, very large incomes, yep, which we didn't have before. The incomes were one of our biggest challenges to increasing the price of real estate. And now we're seeing venture capitalists come down. Miami has its first unicorn, which actually happened in Brickell. It's called Park Jockey. So these are all great stories about how our economy is evolving, and we're seeing venture capitalism and investment type firms moving here because of the tax benefits that they're getting, and the great weather that we have, and the fact that they can live well and work remotely for what they do.
I would add to that also, we're a great environment for the entrepreneur. There are very few places in the country where the entrepreneurs embraced as we are down here. And that's even caused like another university, Babson University, which a world-renowned school is now here with a satellite campus in Miami. It's to drive that.
You know, Mo, this should make you feel very proud, because, you know, the foundation that you've laid for us for your whole career, I mean, I've known you for 40 plus years now, and I've watched you and now take our story on a national, international level. And there's a group called the Tax Foundation. The Tax Foundation was founded in 1937, and this organization's sole purpose in being is to help government leaders around the world to understand their own tax programs and their policies. And the Tax Foundation does lots of rankings, but one of the most important rankings for us is that they rank the friendliness of your taxes in your state. And they rank Florida number 4 out of the 50 states in the United States for being the friendliest tax state in the country. And of course, we've talked in some of our other sessions the fact that we do not have a state income tax here. That's very important no matter where you're coming from, because if you're going to produce income, if you live in Florida, you're not going to pay any state income tax, whereas in some other states you could pay upwards to 13% additional tax over and above federal tax. So Mo, I know you've tracked a lot of these, and you know a lot of these happened because of your hard work, but what are some of the other accolades and surveys that we appear as a state and as a community on?
Well, a couple things. Number one, Teresa did a great job this morning about telling you how Miami has difference themselves from other areas of the country. And as a matter of fact, she incorporated some information that I was going to give you. So I called the office and accessed some things that we walk about and talk about. And that is that Outside Magazine named Miami in the top 15 best places to live in the U.S. Smart Access ranks Miami in the top 10 locations for millionaires. Economist Magazine marks Miami as a top 50 cities in the world for livability. The National Association of Home Builders ranks Miami in their top markets in the United States to live in. U.S. News and World Report ranks Miami in the top 20 places to retire in 2020. And the Miami Herald says Florida ranked within seven states of millennial millionaires relocating to Southeast Florida. Look, the reality is that the cachet of Miami has changed dramatically in the last 15 years and will continue to change as international investment continues to pour in. But the thing that the dais has already talked about that really inspires me is the fact that our people are getting excited about Miami, the folks that live and work in the United States, principally in the Northeast and the West. When you've got big money coming in from the Northeast to buy places like Wynwood and Mimo and some of the other areas that are redeveloping in Miami, that's a tremendous indication that the smart money and real money in this country, especially in the financial sectors, has located themselves and believes in the long-term growth of Miami. The other thing that I think that we need to talk about a little bit is the vertical growth of residential and the minimizing of the size of that vertical growth, where people, especially in first-time homeownerships, may be living in a 400 or 500 square foot condominium, paying the same square footage rate, but because of the smaller site size, will pay a lesser amount. The thing that we've seen from a residential standpoint, in my estimation over the last few years, is that low interest rates simply and of themselves will not inspire first-time home buyers. First-time home buyers are the incubators, are the golden egg that lays the rest of the platform for growth and enhancement in an area. We know that first-time home buyer inspires us to go on to buy another one, make that use home that we bought, an equity base for new homes, other investments, new business, our kids' education, all of the things that are important. The interesting part of that is if we don't inspire that and interest rates aren't the only ticket, what else is? And I think we've got to get back to what really drove home ownership in the early 50s and 60s, and that's federally backed and private lending institutions that don't give you the liar loans that existed in 2006, 7, and 8, but give you lower down payments where folks can get in and then ensconce themselves and begin that home ownership lead. That's enormously important.
Okay, let's talk about that first-time home buyer. Who is that first-time home buyer? I think one of the things that our industry has been watching is that the first-time home buyer is waiting longer in age to purchase. You know, there's been a lot of talk about the millennials. You know, for all you millennials in the room, you know, you've gotten kind of some hard knocks your whole life, I guess, but you now have come of age and you're proving yourself, and you're not just the kids who are living in the basement of their parents' homes anymore. Most of you in this room have never lived in your parents' basement, but the millennials are what are characterized now as 23 to 38 years old. It's 73 million people in the U.S. It's 22% of our U.S. population now. It's the identical size this year to the baby boomers. Now, we baby boomers are going the other direction now. So we're going to continue to see the millennial group increase. Now, you ask, well, how can an age bracket between 23 to 38 increase? They're already here. Well, demographers are telling us that we can expect another 3 million just in that age bracket over the next 4 or 5 years because of immigration. So I think that we will continue to see, obviously, more people in that millennial group. It's the largest buying group that we have. And now I'll ask you guys, what do we see in that buyer today versus when we were in that? Well, you're probably, you know, you were there. You're still, you can talk from both sides.
I appreciate that, but I'm definitely not a millennial.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
But 25 year old in law school.
a little bit older. We have though opportunities now for these people to buy that have never been. They hadn't been thinking about buying maybe like our parents were thinking about buying, or we were thinking about buying. So what do you see different about the millennial just a few years ago and today?
So a few years ago, we actually tried to run some campaigns expecting that they were going to be really wanting to be in the innovative, swanky, new areas of Miami. And we found that that more, like you said, they were waiting longer to buy and were actually a more sophisticated buyer than one expected. So we've gone changing a little bit about the amenities and the things that we're providing to that demographic. And we spoke about this a little bit yesterday, but for those of you that weren't here, we're adding more amenities that are work-home type amenities, giving them the ability to stay and work at their house because they're doing remote jobs, because they're actually employed in New York or in Chicago or in California, but they're living in Miami, and so they're living and working at home. And then they're also looking for lifestyle, you know, proximity to things like that. In the secondary market, we're finding that several of them are also buying homes. So it's almost like you have two completely different groups. Believe it, we just sold a $2.5 million house to a couple of 25-year-olds that are very happy to be in a very large home, but then we also have the group that's looking for the micro unit in a much nicer area. So they're pretty diverse and spread out in terms of what type of product they're looking for, and I suppose that has to do a little bit about what their upbringing and background is like.
Okay.
You know, I agree with that. Sorry, go ahead, Mo.
No, go ahead.
I would add that I think developers are reimagining the type of space that millennials are looking for in the context of recognizing that millennials have sort of come to terms with the reality that real estate's a good investment. And so we're seeing much more efficient units being developed in all of our markets. And it's not very different from other major metropolitan markets around the world where you would have a two-bedroom that was half of the size of what we were traditionally building a two-bedroom to be, and the same would be said for a one and a three and a four. So the amount of space that a millennial would typically look for is much less than what we might have historically been looking for people in that same age category. But we like to think about it as the millennials are growing up and they're realizing that they're going to have families and they're going to need space and they're going to have homes and they want to make solid investments. And with today's interest rates, and I agree with you, interest rates in and of themselves are not enough to stimulate that first-time home buyer, but when you look at the cost of renting versus the cost of buying and the long-term capital depreciation, many millennials who are now mature professionals are recognizing that there is an opportunity to get into the real estate market, but they may not need 4,000 square feet at $1,000 a foot. So if you can compact that space into 1,800 square feet and still apply the same price per foot, the cost of living for that millennial is much less money. But I think we all need to come to terms with the reality that millennials are no longer those people that aren't going to work and aren't going to do and aren't going to buy and aren't going to live, because they are. They are making changes, and I think millennials will be recategorized in the near future.
Absolutely. And the only thing I would add to that is I think you're seeing a difference in the younger millennial versus the older millennial.
Totally.
Because that generation, they formed families, they gained relationships at a later point in time than previous generations had. So they're older as they move to the single family homes or perhaps the first townhome. However, what I'm noticing is that the younger millennials are actually thinking about investing at a much earlier age because their information is available to them that wasn't available 20 and 30 and 40 years ago. They're being brought up with that information. So they have the mindset of, I need to buy a property for investing. And that's what often their first properties are.
Right. The other part of that is that the boomers, folks my age, are hanging around longer. So we don't trade up for the most part.
A lot maybe. Longer, yeah, that's right.
Maybe we're the ATMs for the pharmacies and the medical communities. But we don't trade up generally. We trade sideways or down. Interestingly enough, the millennials are representing about one-third of all new home purchases and used home purchases in the United States, according to NAR. But what's happening is they're moving from areas like Metro Miami to secondary and tertiary sites, especially when transportation is available to them, and then using that transportation in some cases to come back. In other cases, most of them work from their house. What we have to be concerned about and concentrate about is how do we keep them in our metro? What is it that we can give them to make sure that it's not simply just the interest rate, but maybe the type of loan that's provided for them and or the surrounding community? Because like has been already said, a lot more than simply the space that they live in is important to them. The practicality of a single person creating their own breakfast, lunch, and dinner in-house ain't going to happen. But if they're walking distance from good restaurants, from entertainment, from recreation, then you've got all of that as a plus, and that's what Miami offers them. How do you keep them in Metro? That's the question I think is real important.
Well, speaking of that, where do we see all buyers today placing their value? I mean, where are they, what's attracting them to pay more for a particular property? I mean, is it location? Is it the design of the home? Is it the age of the home? Is it the sustainability of the home? I mean, what are you seeing when you're out with buyers? Well, I know most of us are not actually out showing a lot of properties anymore, but we're certainly hearing about a lot of it, and we're exposed to what our associates are telling us. But what are these buyers today willing to pay more for in the marketplace, maybe that's different than it was 10 years ago?
So I think all of the points you just mentioned are important at one point or another to a buyer. And it, I guess the driver mostly would be lifestyle, which is a combination of location. Going back to what we were saying, though, because I think they tie in together, in terms of the millennials, we're also getting a huge interest from the empty nesters. The Gen Xers are either upgrading or also moving. So we have a vast variety of demographics that are interested in Miami, and hence Miami delivers a vast variety of different products for those people. We see millennials that are even moving to the Gables. Now, they're not moving to the large, exciting townhomes and homes that we're delivering, but there's several condo products and urban core product that's being delivered that's seeing some of that movement. Same thing in Doral. You're seeing a different type of product being delivered where developers are even including schools within that community to cater to that demographic that's interested there. There's some great things happening in Kendall and Homestead. So going back to some of the comments that we made yesterday, is Miami is a lot of different boroughs, a lot of different areas, and the diversity of the buyer that we have is forcing us to deliver a diversity of different product.
You know, I think it's very similar to what we experience in New York City. For those of you that know New York City, you know that 20 years ago, it was very location specific. Every buyer would have an idea of where they wanted to live. I credit my chairman with pointing this out to us, that historically, someone would be an Upper East Sider, and it wouldn't matter what you delivered in Tribeca, they were going to be an Upper East Sider because that's where they wanted to be. Today, New York, I think, is very similar to what we're experiencing in South Florida. People are product driven. If you build the product that attracts the buyer is willing to look outside of what they would traditionally look at. We're seeing a lot of movement. We're seeing movement from Miami Beach to Coconut Grove, from Coconut Grove to Coral Gables. We're seeing movement to northern parts of Florida because the product has evolved in those markets. And I think the product that's really capturing people varies depending upon the individual's needs. We call, as Mo mentioned, baby boomers are no longer sizing down. They're just making moves. So they're selling their single family home in South Miami, and they're moving into a product that might be equal or greater price, but in a vertical residence. So they're moving into a condominium because they want to be able to lock the door and go away. They don't want to deal with the groundskeeper. They don't want to deal with the roofing issue. They don't want to deal with the maintenance responsibilities, and they want the amenitization. And I'm very excited about the amenitization that we're offering in all of our products and what our competitors and developers are offering, because I think it's much more curated to the specific needs of the end user. So we're not seeing the traditional, you know, card room, shuffleboard course, and what they would call a gym that had a couple of machines in it. We're seeing specifically curated amenities that are catering to the needs of, and the potential needs of the end users. We're seeing children's playrooms that are superiorly curated by world-renowned children experts. We have a project on Miami Beach, the Ritz-Carlton Residences, that has an art room where we literally simulate 24-hour-a-day outdoor lighting so that a painter can come in at 11 o'clock at night when they put their children to bed and start painting all night. And the list goes on and on and on. One of the things that I'm most impressed by is the use of outdoor space. It's kind of amazing. We've historically been building balconies in South Florida. They're about as big to put maybe a lawn chair on. But today, we have projects where the outdoor space is almost as large as the indoor space. One of our projects, it's worth noting, is 87 Park in Surfside, Miami, Miami Beach. The outdoor space is literally 70% of the size of the interior space. Every single unit has an outdoor kitchen. And it makes sense. If you're moving to Florida and you're coming from a market like New York, why not be able to dine outside? Why not be able to cook outside? Why not have your windows completely retract so that when you're entertaining guests or even hanging out with your family, you're able to experience that indoor-outdoor living concept? So people are being driven to the product that aligns specifically with their needs and their uses. And one thing I firmly agree with, accessibility. If you're someone that wants to walk, you're going to go to a location where you're able to walk outside and walk to a restaurant. If you're somebody that's going to travel to and from the airport every day or every other week, you're going to go somewhere where you have easy access to the airport, because we all know that traffic is an issue and congestion is a consideration. So accessibility, lifestyle, wellness is driving all these decisions.
You know, the accessibility really is some of our older areas that have been established back in the 20s and 30s and 40s. What are we seeing in remodeling and restorations in some of these neighborhoods, and what impact is that having on the market?
We're seeing a lot of that. I mean, you know, over the course of the last 10 years, 12 years at this point, we've seen a lot of fix and flippers. You know, thank you HGTV for helping everybody with that vision. And now you've seen a ton of people, not just the professionals, but the newer professionals come in and do that. And when people take a look at it, and that's what resellers have to look at. They have to look at the rehabs that other homes, you know, had been done. So when an agent would go in and price a home in the past, historically they would look and they wouldn't necessarily see all of the additional amenities and upgrades that the neighboring homes had done. And today they have to take that into consideration when pricing these properties, because we've seen a lot of it.
When Jessica was speaking yesterday, she had a slide there that said that 71% of the respondents said that they wanted to buy a home like the ones they see on TV.
Correct.
And I think that that's true. And we're finding that people who are remodeling homes in this neighborhood where we're sitting are seeing significant increases in price just immediate, you know, from the, after the remodeling, because that's just the only thing that people want to look for.
Well, people look for that, and people just don't want to, they may not have vision, they may not have design themselves, and they just want to, you know, an ease, have a product that they can move into and they don't have to do anything to it other than bring their furnishings and the decor, and that's it. And so that's is helping move that market. The other thing is, you know, you hit a time and point over several years. So I'm just, you know, looking at the Western markets for a second. And so anywhere from Kendall all the way up, we can take it all the way through Broward up to Coral Springs. Effectively, these homes over the last few years have aged. They're now 20, 30 plus years old. So you've got new roofs going on. You've got new kitchens. You've got everything having to go into them from a necessity standpoint, not just aesthetically. So,
you know, Danny, go ahead.
Ron, the one thing we haven't really touched on, but and I know we all experience it, is if you're on the road in Miami between 6 and 9 in the morning or 3 and 7 in the afternoon, you're probably in gridlock. I don't care where you are, even on a Sunday in some cases. But areas of expertise, especially today, areas of exponential growth are in the south end of town, heretofore areas that never were considered areas that would entertain new growth there. Gould's, Lower Homestead, Leisure City, where it would take an hour and a half transit from the center core of Miami during those rush hour periods. But we're still seeing a great deal of people who are committing to the fact that, hey, I need to buy, I need to get in at a price point that makes sense to me and that I can afford. And those places are beginning to grow and exponentially in compared to some of the places that we see in center core city today. The other thing is, when I started 48 years ago selling houses, the three things that everybody told me were important was location, price, and condition. I think those things are still the same, but I think they depend on, and the dais has said it more than once, on what the interests are for that specific buyer. Single or newly married without children, location becomes extremely important. Maybe now with a kid or two, location and price become important because the kids are going to go to school. And condition, for an old guy, I'm not willing to go outside and mow the lawn and do the stuff that I did before. So that those things change in time, and you've got to be able to at least pigeonhole your buyer, and your seller for that matter, to understand where you're going to take them in that process. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's exactly right, and it kind of leads into, Dan, you mentioned earlier about the fact that we're having more permanent buyers moving here. You know, jobs are growing. Our economic development agency in Dade County is called the Miami-Dade County Beacon Council. And the Beacon Council and the Greater Miami Chamber of Commerce years ago started an organization called One Community, One Goal. And it has targeted seven unique industries that we wanted to build in Miami. And now looking back over these last decade plus, we're seeing the benefits of all of that hard work and effort. And, you know, what are some of those companies that you guys see now that are moving into town, expanding here, bringing more people, permanent jobs, you know, more roots being planted here?
I mean, clearly all the tech companies are making a big push. We're building tech sectors in Miami that are capable of handling the needs of those technology firms. So all the big names, you all know them, Google, Amazon, and so on and so forth, they're all making a move here. But it's also important to talk about the established companies that we've had here for a long time. You know, one great example is a company called World Fuel. A lot of people don't really even know what that company is, but it's one of the largest firms in Florida. And you know, they're based in a western area of Florida. They're in Doral. They're not in the Brickell area. People often think of maybe Brickell as a financial sector or different areas, but it's not one area of Miami that's the financial sector. It's Brickell, Coral Gables, and basically Doral is where you see the large operations of financial transactions happening. So, and to some of our panelists' point, products are being delivered in those different areas to cater to the person who wants to live the lifestyle in that area. So you're seeing $3 million homes very, 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 very far west. You never would have thought that you'd see $3 million homes in the western areas, in the Doral areas, but they're being delivered and they're actually being sold. We're also seeing the sustainability, which we talked about yesterday. There's now more consciousness about that, and there are buyers that are interested in a home being self-sustaining, where you're seeing the solar panels and the collection of water and the special R ratings and insulations on the structures to facilitate being more sustainable. So we are delivering different products in different areas to cater to many different demographics, which is all of these generations that we've been talking about. And to that point, and to your point of congestion that you mentioned, we're also delivering areas that people can stay in and enjoy. So now you don't have only great restaurants on the eastern side of Miami. They're on the west. You have great schools on the west. You have great areas of shopping on the west, so that you don't have to get in an hour of traffic and you can stay in an area. We mentioned yesterday downtown Doral, just because it's so massive, it's a city within a city. It's 250 acres and it has some of the best restaurants, some of the best shopping. My family personally owns a clothing boutique there, you should come by. And we have some outstanding schools all within the same community. So that's a neat concept that we're seeing happen all throughout Miami-Dade County and Broward as well.
And I would say, to your point, Ron, I think when we look at it, it starts with our education system, right? So we've got the University of Miami here. We are graduating an incredible amount of healthcare professionals. We are very well renowned around the world with our hospital systems that we have that have grown from the southern end of Miami all the way up and through Broward County. We have people that come from around the world for the healthcare here, whether it's Bascom for your eyes or the cancer center at any one of the two big major hospitals. So healthcare. In Broward, you've got Nova. So you've got, again, under healthcare, you've got the dentists, and we're graduating an enormous amount of dental practitioners, whether it's traditional dentistry, cosmetic dentistry, anything. We're filling our counties with that. And then you add in technology. You know, in Broward, you've got Magic Leap, and they're being massively funded by all of the big, you know, Google put a ton of money into this company for their new technology. And that's just one of multitude of companies that are bringing their business to South Florida.
And just to give you an example, the Miami Cancer Institute opened 2 years ago. It was a $500 million investment. It's a partnership with Sloan Kettering out of New York and Baptist Health here out of Miami. And in 2 years, they're seeing 1,100 patients a day in the cancer center. And again, this is a 500,000 square feet of space as well. But it just shows the strength of our medical community and the availability of high quality healthcare. You know, we kind of tease that, you know, if you're south of us in the hemisphere and you get really sick, what do you take? You take the first American Airlines flight to Miami to get health care. So I think that more and more people throughout the Caribbean and throughout the Americas are now looking to Miami as the one place, the number one place where they want to come for that. You know, we talk about, you know, our analysts have been looking at currency exchanges and the ebbing and flowing of some of these countries that we have traditionally done business with. Teresa, you've had those on your charts yesterday and today. You know, we still see a lot of people from those areas, but as we see these companies or these countries ebb and flow, you know, we begin to detect that pretty quickly as we see movements, whether in government leadership in some of these countries or currency exchanges. You know, where do we see that ebbing and flowing right now as we look forward into, you know, 2020? You know, where are we expecting our buyers from out of the country to come from?
Well, I do a little more commercial today than I did when I first started in the industry. My wife does most of the residential. The Wall Street Journal today is probably the best indication of where Florida and the rest of the U.S. economy will be. On the front page, it says U.S. outpaces the world in economics. Sound economic data and robust earnings, light blue chips today, plus the economy for the entire nation. Listen, people with scared money, funny money, real money, old money, want to protect their money.
Funny money.
So they look, true story, they look for the very best places to do that. It's nice to find those places within your own community. It's better to find those places that have long-term appreciation and absolute hard asset low liability like the United States. So you look at the cachet of the United States and where you look, New York, California, the Midwest, and now Miami has gotten the cachet within that realm of folks. I had the opportunity within the last few months to sit with Governor DeSantis, and he gave me a couple numbers that really floored me. He said 120 million visitors come to the state of Florida every year. 120 million new people into our state. They don't come here to live, but eventually they make up a portion of those thousands of people that come in and the thousand net that stay. The other thing he said was that Florida itself, if their GDP was calculated within the confines of a country, they would be the 20th largest GDP in the world. The reality is that we're growing exponentially, and Miami is growing critically in contrast to the rest of the country. Miami's cachet will generate the kind of activity in those secondary and tertiary cities once we're connected by rail, once we're connected by other types of transportation. Look for the East Coast to just boom. Everything up and down through Jacksonville and what I call the H in Florida, somewhere around Naples up to about Tampa area, and then across I-4. Those areas will boom, in my estimation, beyond belief. But now some areas beyond that also, because the retirement communities are beginning to boom. Are we in a particularly good location for the rest of, let's say, 2019, 2020? In my estimation, yes. Are we great for a long-term appreciation in the state of Florida and particularly in Miami-Dade County? Look, this is only my opinion. It's based on 48 years with one of the worst real estate recessions we've ever seen. I don't think we're gonna see that again. We'll see bumps and levels because that's the way we go. But the reality is, if you want to be someplace in the next 20 years to make money in real estate, this is the place to be.
You know, speaking of that, I tell you, I love listening to you. You got more data than I can remember. But you talk about all these opportunities that we have. Markets have come up and down. But when you look in our inventory today, if you go into our multiple listing system today, half of our inventory of condominiums, half of our inventory of condominiums are less than 10 years old. Now, you know, we're such a new city. You know, when you go into most cities, I mean, you go to Europe, I mean, my goodness, you guys that are from Europe, I mean, you know, if something's less than 500 years old, it's like new. But here, half of our inventory now is less than 10 years old in the condominium market. condominiums, single-family homes, about a quarter of the inventory is less than 10 years old. So when we talk about remodeling and, you know, even those homes, I'm not talking about those homes, I'm talking about brand new homes that were just built in the last 10 years. So we have a great offering of properties. Our values in the over $1 million market are some of the best that we've had in the last 4 years. You know, we have a little bit of an oversupply right now, so we're balancing that out. But as you heard yesterday in some of the comments, you know, we will eat through that quickly because we have so many people coming here to buy what we have. And not until the last couple of years have we had such an influx of domestic buyers that we have today. I mean, we basically built this marketplace for the last 40, 50 years on the international buyer. And now we're transitioning to have a multi-pronged buyer from the Northeast, from the rest of the United States, as well as, of course, the rest of the world. So, you know, Mo, everything you've been talking about is exactly what's happening and what will continue to happen with greater velocity.
I think it's also just important, as you comment about where are the foreign buyers coming from, the variables that drive foreign buyers into this market are clear. They're either economic or political. Right now, the situation in Mexico, I just read this morning that 6 Americans were killed at gunpoint. The political instability of some of the Latin American countries continue to make South Florida, Miami in particular, a prime target for investment and opportunity. I think some people say that Miami is the closest part of Latin America to America. Is that the right way to say it?
Well, yeah, Miami's number one asset is our close proximity to the United States.
Right, exactly. So Ron says it better. But I think that we understand that Latin American markets have historically more volatility than we do in the United States, which is a reason why we've been such a hotspot for Latin American investment. We can't ignore Canada. Canada faces a similar demographic as we do in terms of the age of the population, and similarly, many of the people in Canada that are reaching that baby boomers and even the empty nesters are now looking to South Florida. And the price point of our inventory is still remarkably opportunistic for them. And I think, frankly, opportunistic for everybody. You know, we oftentimes talk about the New York buyer. And, you know, when you take a New York buyer that is paying $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 a foot, Miami's a bargain. And we look at people that have purchased here luxury inventory 10 years ago for $350 a foot, and that inventory is trading today for $1,500 a foot. They think it's outrageously expensive. But we are partners with Knight Frank globally, and we look at what are the most important investment markets or cities in the world. And Miami has now moved into the top 10, which is an incredible spot to be in considering that it's a global approach. And I think that Miami will continue to hold that position with strength because of the fact that we are benefiting from so many different variables. Most notably, which we didn't talk about today, was the changeover in the way that developers are allowing people to invest. So the period of the volatility in our market, the last recession, you could buy a condominium putting down a 5 or a 10% deposit. That combined with the outrageous lack of structure in the finance markets created an implosion. Today, most developers, at least all of them that we're working with, are requiring anywhere from 30 to 50% deposits, which provides a level of hedge in the market. So if the market did take a downturn, which I don't foresee happening, and our reports are indicating that the strength is stable, people wouldn't have the opportunity to dump their units or walk away from their contracts. They're going to be forced to close. And, you know, it's interesting because Ron mentioned how quickly the inventory absorbed in the last downturn. Right when that market started to fall, the number of phone calls that I was receiving from New York institutions wanting to capitalize on that, the smart money, you know, you talked about the different types of money, the smart money was immediately looking to pounce on that opportunity. And I think everybody knows at this point globally that South Florida and Miami are an extraordinarily interesting and opportunistic real estate market.
Okay, I'm going to give you all a question, an opportunity in a couple of minutes here to ask some questions. So be thinking about 3 or 4 of you that have a question. You can ask that in just a couple of minutes. And as we go to that, those questions, I want to ask you guys about some of the styles of our architecture. I mean, this community that we're sitting in here today was modeled after much of Spain. This building, the Giralda Tower on top of this, is in Sevilla, Spain. The Giralda Tower in Sevilla, Spain is still standing there today. It looks exactly like the tower on this hotel. This hotel, incidentally, was built in 1926. The developer of our community, George Merrick, built this hotel in 10 months. And you can imagine in 1926 without all the tools that we have today to build. It built this hotel in 10 months, and of course it's been a strategic part of the Gables for all these years. But 15% of the housing in Coral Gables, it was initially built here in the 20s and 30s, was of a Mediterranean style, and now we're starting to see other styles. So, you know, just comment on what you're seeing out in the marketplace. Obviously, you know, everything from, you know, very traditional to very sleek and different.
I think, as the builder, I think you should go first.
Ladies first.
I think what we're seeing is a shift to more modern, a very more modern style is what we're seeing being built. Also sustainable. The millennial buyer is actually looking for more sustainable in their housing, and we know commercially they've been doing it. However, residentially, I think we're going to see more and more of it. You see it around the country in markets like California and Colorado, Austin, Texas, where everything is built towards sustainability, and I think we're going to start to see more of that from that generation is going to force us to build that way.
I think you're getting a diversity. I mean, Miami's a global city, and so you're getting architects from around the world, whether it's a Philip Stark, Zaha Hadid, the list goes on and on, Carlos Ott. I mean, you're getting the best of the best from around the world, so you look at some of this architecture, and they're works of art. One of the most beautiful ones we have here today is Una, which is back there. We mentioned it earlier, but that architecture is spectacular. Flatiron's also here. It's another great set of architecture. So you're getting product that's very diverse for the diverse global buyer that we have. And then you have some more of the sleek, modern looks as well in the housing. And it's being done around. Some communities are more open to that sort of architecture than others. But it is something that's in demand. And the neat thing is that we have both contemporary, modern, and all sorts of different types of architecture for all of those communities.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Mo, go ahead.
There are two areas of construction that I think are kind of interesting because they're brand new, but being developed, especially in Arizona and now here, Miami Association, I know, was one of the stalwarts in installing a single-family home built around containers. You can couple in containers like you can stack them or drag them out in either direction. That probably is one of the newer styles of housing, but I saw one the other day. Some folks from New Hampshire contacted us and showed us a self, how do I put this? A home that builds itself on site. The home builds itself on site based on hinges. They're still trying to get permits, and code enforcement is working with them in the South Florida area, but you can get an 800-square-foot home on a small lot, and I mean a small lot if you can do it, that will build itself in less than 24 hours and cost you about $60,000 or $70,000 total for the home itself, not including the permitting and the construction. So architecture is important, but I think a lot of our folks are beginning to realize that some type of shelter and investment on an initial level is better than no investment at all. And that, by the way, I agree with you. I think Miami's long term for a long time, and the folks from the Northeast have already committed themselves. They saw Tribeca, they saw the Bronx, they saw Brooklyn, they saw all of that activity and all of that energy. And they look down here and they say, golly, we can buy in Wynwood for $1,500 or $2,000 a square foot. We live here. We think to ourselves, oh my God, Wynwood, $2,000 a square foot? I can't do that. That's insane. That's not true. They understand the viability of those locations, especially those locations, because they're spitting distance from the beaches. The climate's important. The location's important because it's relatively close to the water. It's near the central core. $1,500 a square foot. You can't buy a pied de terre. Is that the way you say it?
Pied de terre.
Pied de terre.
Thanks. You can't buy a small condo overlooking the Eiffel Tower for less than about 500 square feet for less than about $6 or $7 million.
You can buy four of our gleaming new condominiums in downtown Miami for the price of one in Manhattan.
Yeah.
I know the New Yorkers will take exception to that, but that's true.
I wanted to add one thing.
Sure.
Sorry, Ron. I think it's important at the global conference. If you look at the number of Pritzker Award-winning architects from foreign markets that are now gracing our skyline with their architecture. It's really phenomenal, from Renzo Piano to Zaha Hadid to John Nouvel. I mean, these are people that build museums, and they're now here gracing our landscape with these works of art, which we talk about the single family home evolution from the big white boxes and how sophisticated they become. But really interestingly, we've now incorporated light, height. I mean, most of our condo buildings that we're building today are 10 to 11 foot clear ceiling height, much more outdoor space, but also with that level of architecture, which is complemented by the extraordinary talent of the architects in this community, we're seeing functionality that is rising to a whole nother level. So the simple floor plans, the basic configuration, is really being replaced by functionality, where things as interesting as the distance from the water closet to the powder room, from the bedroom to the guest suite, from the direction that the kitchen faces and its proximity to the bay that they can look out at. All of these things are being incorporated now at such a high level that you're really seeing the evolution of the product in every aspect, from the western parts of the market where the price points are lower to the top of the core of our market where the price points are at its highest. The functionality, the quality, the sophistication is just at another level, which I think is enhancing the appeal of our market at every single level, giving that $400,000 new home buyer a product that blows their mind as much as it gives that $40 million penthouse buyer a product that blows their mind. It's exciting to be a part of it.
Any questions? Anybody have a question? Okay, we're going to wrap up here in a second then.
That's how good a job Ron always does.
Last chance. Okay, each one of my team members here, we're going to comment on our outlook for the rest of this year and into 2020, and what are the market indicators that we should all be watching? So what's your outlook for the rest of this year, next year, and what market indicators should we be watching? Who wants to go first?
Well, I like to look at days on market. I think it's a good indicator of what the real strength is of the inventory. I think ultimately, if you see that the days on market are increasing exponentially, then it shows you that the buyer pool is not as strong or not as much interest there. I think inventory is difficult to judge because there's new inventory coming onto the market. But overall, I would tell you that I think the buyer profile that's coming into this market today, they don't have to make an urgent decision. They're not buying specifically for investment purposes, so they're more patient. So we have to layer in over our inventory and our days on market, and whether prices are up or down, they seem pretty stable. We have to layer in, is it because of the fact that the people that are buying now are taking more time to make decisions? And I think they are. But I would tell you, as it looks for 19 and 20, I think this market's going to maintain its strength. I think we're going to see overall a robust real estate market, both in Miami and for the rest of the markets, both on the eastern coast and the western coast of Florida.
Daniel.
So I'm going to agree and disagree in certain areas. So what I'll tell you right now is what we're seeing is we're seeing a pause in certain parts of the market. I know the industry is feeling it a little bit. And it's really all about pricing. It's when we get ahead of ourselves, this is what we feel, right? So it's a matter of the markets just being able to connect and correct and catch up to that. The other thing I think we're also experiencing is from a interest rate perspective, and, you know, I know Mo shared earlier, interest rates aren't the only driver. However, when buyers sit on the sidelines and they believe the Fed will continue to drop interest rates, they hold on the sideline to see where is that actual bottom going to come. I think the fact that the Fed now just gave us a little indication that they're kind of done for a while may push some more people back into our markets to realize like we're sort of there. And again, we're going into 2020. It's an election year. An election year is always a very interesting year in our industry. And so there are a lot of unknowns that come with that. But we've got things happening globally. Look, there are elections that just took place in South America in a week, and we have several countries headed left right now. That does very well for our marketplace. So there's always a lot of unknowns. Everybody always asks, Natasha, what is your crystal ball saying? I said, if I had a crystal ball, I'd be a very wealthy woman, and I wouldn't be sitting here with you today. So that's what I can tell you.
Okay.
Listen, if you haven't gotten the idea that I think this is a great place to be in the real estate industry, then I probably haven't communicated well. I think 2019 for the duration of the year is going to be just as good as it has been for the beginning of the year. I think 2020 will have a moderate increase but still an increase in a long period of time. I think there's no better place to be than southeastern United States, and especially Florida, for all the reasons that you've heard before. Understand, I'm going to give you an example, and then I'm going to close out. One, my dad bought my mom a house on Northeast 71st Street near the bay, paid $16,000 for that house, FHA, put about $500 down. That house, and was upset, by the way, because when he came home, I remember, they increased the interest rate on him from 4.75% to 4.875%, and he was livid. And the difference might have been a few bucks. The reality, that house today is in the 500,000 plus range. I look it up all the time because I like to take a peek at where I used to live. Real estate is not a short-term investment. It's a basis for wealth for long-term. I don't mean to take all of your assets and put it in real estate, although I probably have. But the reality is that real estate over a long term is very predictable. It goes up, then levels and comes down a bit, and then goes up higher than it was in the previous case, levels, comes down a bit, and then goes up again. And that has been the criteria for real estate for a long period of time. We said before, the worst recession that real estate has ever had, and especially in South Florida, that 2006 to 2008 period, where our prices literally dropped from a third to a half and sometimes less, real investors took a look at that and said, my God, I can buy on the steps of the sand for $140 a square foot or less. That's already developed, already in place. Where else in the world can I do that with this cachet? And they invested big time. Should that ever happen again, which I don't believe it's gonna, believe me, the energy in South Florida will drive you out of your seat. Here is the one thing you've got to do. If you really want to be proficient and professional and efficient and effective, you've got to be constantly involved in the real estate profession. People are living in their homes longer, which means there's less inventory. When I was young, it was like 7 to 10 years. Now it's like 10 to 13 years. And that inventory, that's first-time home buyer, even in the areas that Ron and the rest of these folks invest in and do business in, at that million-dollar-plus level, is smaller. Florida is unique, but Miami is even more unique. It is small parcels in nature, not big hunks of land, and we don't have a lot left. So assemblages are real important. This period in our involvement, I think, is going to last for a good 20 years. I may not last as long as that, but you may. And looking at Florida, I think you're in the right place at the right time, no question in my mind.
So I would say that Florida, Miami in particular, is so diverse that it really goes down to different areas. And it's, I mean, all the points that everybody's made are important, but there's a little bit more detail that goes into them, because days on market could be relevant, but then the style of the property is also relevant. And if you notice, for example, in Pinecrest, your Spanish barrel tile roof product is lasting on market longer than your modern property. And the only way you know that is by being vested in the area. And most of you, or lots of you that are here, are not from here. You work remotely, you're doing business with Miami, but remotely. So what I would encourage you to do is have a relationship with a local asset, with somebody here that can help you go through that process and know each different area. The Starkitects are great, but the innovations in product that we're having is outstanding. And that's going to evolve the market over the next few years. Today, we're delivering products for investors that are offering daily rental and income opportunities. And that's one type of market, and that will have its own life. We're also delivering innovative product that has shared common elements in land. So it's a smaller piece of property that your larger home's on, because you have shared common elements in land. So these are all important points to have a close relationship with someone here. Miami, I believe, will be the leader constantly in the evolution of real estate and bringing new ideas and new concepts of construction. But the different boroughs and the different areas and the different locations are very specific. So I would encourage you to have a relationship with someone here, because as everyone here said, this is a very long-term business, and buying something today is going to be a long-term concept for you and your clients.
You know, we've heard about a lot of things here, months of supply. The optimum number of months of supply in our industry and our marketplace is 6 to 9 months for the overall market. So if we have 6 to 9 months of supply, we feel like we have enough buyers, enough sellers. Sellers are getting a fair return. The buyers don't feel like they're getting gouged. Once you go below 6 months of supply, prices will continue to go up, and as we have seen now for the last decade, you know, again, Jessica talked yesterday about the fact that we've had an increase in pricing in the United States for the past 91 months uninterrupted. Ours is actually a little bit longer than that. For almost the last decade now, we have seen prices steadily increase, and of course, it's about supply and demand at the end of the day. We don't have any more land left in that lower price range under $1 million. We only have 5 months of supply, so we will continue to see pressure on that market for people to find housing at those prices that they can afford. In the over $1 million market, we have more inventory there than we would need. We can handle about 10 to 18 or 12 to 18 months in the over $1 million market. In some cases, we have significantly more than that, but our sellers and those prices have been very understanding this year, you know, finally after about 3 years to reduce prices in many cases. So I would argue that we probably have the best offering of properties and the best pricing that we have had in the last 4 years. So now's the time for people that are really serious about buying to buy. And I know that a lot of those people are on the sidelines. I do believe that we probably have more pent-up demand for luxury housing in South Florida than we've ever had in history. We have so many people that are just waiting for that moment to strike. And of course, it's hard to hit that very bottom of the market, and many times people miss it, and then they buy on the, and as it's going back up, eventually it will go back up from where we are today in the high-end prices, because we don't have any more supply. And as we heard again yesterday, you know, the supply is being exhausted. So thank you, Teresa, and folks here, thank you.